And I do very seriously appreciate the woman, wherever she is, that gave that prophetic word, because we really do have a purpose, wherever you are. She's back in the corner. Okay, we truly do have a purpose. And that is different for everyone, but there's something that is in common for all of us. And do you turn to your Bible in this church?
Yeah.
Now and then? One of the Gospels is called Mark. If you turn to it, Mark chapter 3. Oh,
that is. It on the screen,
oh, okay. Oh, that's right. So all the phones are chiming here. Okay, go for it. Mark chapter 3 and verse 13. Jesus went up on a mountainside and he called to him those he wanted. He went up to the mountainside and called those he wanted. One translation says, those he desired. Now, there is a verse that says, many are called, but few are chosen. And it's wonderful to be among the chosen. And it's the grace of God that has given us the avenue to come to Christ. And so we really appreciate that Christ desired us. It wasn't that he just looked at us and said, oh, okay, I'll just take you. He wanted us. It was more than just a casual acquaintance. So Jesus went up to the mountainside and he called to himself those he wanted, and they came to him. See, that's the second part of this. It's great. It wasn't that the people he called stayed aloof, but they came to him. Goes on to say, he appointed 12, designating them apostles. And then this is my favorite part of this verse. He called them, and he called them apostles, that they might be with him. Now, the purpose for those apostles was that they might be sent out to preach and to have authority to drive out demons, but he desired those 12 men to come to him. And the reason he had them come to him is he just wanted to be with him. Now, I pastored for 33 years, and it's very easy to get away from some of the basics and some of the fundamentals of what this is all about. The music's great. The communion is absolutely meaningful. The fellowship that we share with each other is great, and the food is always wonderful. But what it's all about is you and Jesus. And the reason is because he wants to be with you, and we should want to be with him as much as he wants to be with us. So when he called his 12 disciples to be with him, there was something more than just sitting around a campfire. He wanted them to see firsthand when he fed the 5,000. He wanted the disciples to see exactly how he responded to the Pharisees when they insulted him or attacked him or accused him. He wanted the disciples to see firsthand when he said, go thy way, thy son is healed. He wanted the disciples to see with their own eyes what it was to forgive sins and how he would respond to the woman taken in adultery. He wanted the disciples to be so close to him that they would hear his preaching firsthand and be able to ask him questions afterwards and get a response from him. It wasn't just a kumbaya moment between the disciples and Jesus. It was, come, I want to be with you I desire you to be with me so that you can see with your eyes, you could hear with your ears, and your hands can handle the things of life. So now I want you to turn, if you are turning in your Bible or on your phone, to 1 John chapter 1. You ever think that money is so meaningless that I use it for a bookmark? This is a 20,000 rupees. Doesn't it make you feel rich? It's worth maybe 15 cents. Epistle of John, chapter 1. Now, this is John, the son of thunder, one of the 12 that came to Christ. One of the 12 Jesus called. One of the 12 that walked with him, that was a favorite. He wanted to be close to Jesus. Jesus wanted to be close to him. The first verse, that which was from the beginning. That which was from the beginning. Now, when John wrote his gospel, he wrote, in the beginning was the Word. It was Christ. He recognized and understood that way back there in Genesis, when God put the whole program together, he was there. Jesus was there with the Father. He was there at the creation. He made it known emphatically in his first chapter of the Gospel of John. And now as he's writing the first of three epistles, he says, that which was from the beginning. In other words, here is the most important thing. We're not just talking about a prophet. We're not just talking about someone that taught the things of God. We're not just talking about another one of the apostles. We're not just talking about someone who gave us some good philosophy to live by, but that who was with God in creation. This is the one we're talking about. That which was from the beginning. And then he begins to recount that which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked at and our hands have touched. This we proclaim to you concerning Jesus, the Word of life. So what we saw with our eyes, what we heard with our ears, what our hands handled of the Word of life, this is what we're proclaiming or declaring to you. Not something we conjured up, not a new philosophy to get people to follow us, but what we personally experienced with God. Amen. Jesus wanted the disciples to be there so that they would have this on-the-job training program. He wanted them to be there so that they would be able to be witnesses with first-hand accountability and first-hand knowledge of everything that Jesus did. That which we heard with our ears, which we saw with our eyes, which our hands have handled of the Word of life. That's what we're proclaiming. That's what we're doing. That's what we're witnesses to, because that life appeared. He that was with God in the creation appeared to us, and we're testifying of this. I just lost my place here. It says, the life appeared, and we have seen it and testify to it, and we proclaim to you the eternal life. Now, in some translations, it's a little ambiguous. It's like they are there preaching eternal life. No, they're there testifying of the life that was eternal, that was there in the beginning, there walking with them, and there as they watched him ascend back to heaven.
That's right.
So these disciples heard something, They saw something, they touched something, and they went on to testify of it. And the ministry of Jesus continued because they heard and saw and touched. Yeah. Now, where does that leave us? We can't see him like John saw him. We can't hear him like John heard him. And we certainly can't touch him like they did, or like Thomas did, stick his finger in the wound of his hand. But here's something that's interesting to me. In the fifth verse, it says, "This is the message that we have heard from him and declare to you." This is the message we have heard from him and declare to you. And he goes on to talk about that message. But we're not, what's the right word? We're not deficient. We can hear the Holy Spirit. And we can see what God is doing in heaven.
Amen.
And we can be the instruments of God to take what we have heard and what we have seen,
right,
and be an instrument to fulfill the purposes of God here on earth. The Apostle Paul never saw Jesus except by revelation. But he was able to say at one point, who's the brother that talked about communion in the 11th chapter of 1 Corinthians? He wasn't there at the Last Supper. Yet he was able to say, "That which I have received of the Lord deliver I to you," that the same day Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and broke it, and he took the cup and he gave it to him to drink. He saw by revelation. Now we can be just like the Apostle Paul, to be able to hear and see and do.
Yes.
One part that's left out here, it says that life appeared and we proclaim it to you so that you may have fellowship with the Father and with his Son. This fellowship is not what we experience over a cup of coffee. This fellowship that's being talked about here is not a kumbaya moment with God where we just sit quietly and enjoy his presence. This fellowship is very clearly a participation with God.
Amen.
We can hear, we can see, and we can touch. When we see what God is doing and participate with that. Oftentimes what we want to do is we want to get so smart as Christians that we want to come up with a new revelation. We want to come up with a new plan. Maybe God will give me some supernatural new ministry that's not even talked about in the Bible, and I could be that gang out there just doing my thing for Jesus. All I want to do is see what's going on in heaven and somehow, as a conduit, communicate that and fulfill his purpose.
That's good.
It doesn't have to be a program. It doesn't have to be in a Lutheran church. It could be when you're standing in the line at the grocery store. It could be when they're trimming your hair and talking to the person doing the work. But it requires you to be open to hear and to see. It requires you to have the presence of this God living inside of you. So that we could say, like the Apostle Paul, that which I've received from the Lord, I'm going to deliver to you. So that you can have fellowship with the Father. So that you can have fellowship with the Son. So that you now can participate with God and do what He wants you to do. Because what He wants you to do is different than He wants you to do. We don't have to follow a mode or a model. All we have to do is be open to hear and to see and to do. To listen to what the Holy Spirit has to say and then just do it. It might just be a simple word, might be an action, it might just be a friendship. But all we have to do is hear it and see it and do it. And God's not leaving anybody out of the program. He desires to be with all of us. So just like Jesus said, I when He went to the mountaintop, I want you 12 to be with me. Now He's saying, I want you to be with me. One person can only communicate with so many, but the ability of the Holy Spirit to communicate with a multitude and be with a multitude in different situations around the world simultaneously is something the Holy Spirit can do. And the Holy Spirit is as much God as Jesus was, as the Father in heaven is. And Jesus said, I'm going so that He will come and He'll be with you and He'll be just like me. Amen. Just like Jesus. Desiring to be with us so that we can hear and we could see and our hands can handle of the word of life. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we're really grateful for You and for Your wonderful presence and Your love and Your goodness. I really do ask You to bless Bob and Mona. Bless this church. Bless their endeavors. Bless their lives. Help them, Lord, to see and hear and be a blessing to this congregation, this community, and to touch life after life. And we pray, Lord, that You continue to minister to us now and help us during this time as we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Okay, you could put your Bibles and your phones and everything down. We're going to have a little fun, if that's okay. All right, here's what we're going to do. I believe that the Lord gave me a few words of knowledge. I was writing them down there during the worship. And I'm going to identify the different words of knowledge, and I'd like that person to stand, and then they're going to be prayed for. But I'm not going to pray for them. The person I want to pray for them is the one who sees or hears or senses the nudging of the Holy Spirit to pray for them. Because God will designate a certain burden on your heart to go minister to that person. True?
Yeah.
Isn't God big enough to do that? So for whatever reason, he's chosen me to identify him. So I'll identify these needs. And then you stand. And whoever is feeling the urging or the quickening of the Holy Spirit, the nudging of the Holy Spirit, it doesn't have to be a bolt of lightning. Just go lay your hands on him and pray a prayer of faith. Okay? Sure. Okay. The first one is a chronic ulcers, and they're experiencing stomach pain from it. Who? Chronic ulcers. You might not even know it. It's that's it. Mm-hmm. Okay. Who's sensing the urging of the Holy Spirit? If you could do that now. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Okay. Okay, I don't want to interrupt the prayer, but I want to prophesy to that lady too. Amen. Amen. The Lord's going to give you a boldness to be able to deal with some issues in your family and also some issues at work. And it's going to be totally contrary to your personality to be able to be bold and upfront and just attack the situation with a different kind of boldness that you've never experienced before. No, 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 don't do that. Another person is having chronic depression. That could fit a lot of people, but I specifically want to talk to, pray for a person that has chronic depression with headaches. Might not be easy for someone to admit that they are depressed chronically, but you know, Christ is there to make a difference in our lives. Okay, go ahead, stand up.
I have chronic depression, but I don't have the headaches. I've been on antidepressants for probably over 10 years.
Okay, all right, who would like to minister to him? But if there is someone else that is experiencing the headaches as well. Okay. Okay. All right. Let's. Who wants to come? Let's minister to them. Another person doesn't know that they are having the beginning of cataracts, but they're seeing diminished clarity in their vision. Who's that person? Right there. Okay, stay standing. Someone will come and pray for you. Someone's experiencing indigestion so seriously that it keeps them up all night, literally. Someone else is experiencing facial numbness, occasional facial numbness. Someone is had a fall and they have physically not recovered from it. Okay.
That's his wife. He broke his skull this week.
Okay, let's you come in proxy for him. Okay. Let's really trust the Lord for him. Okay, who would like to pray for him? His name was
Larry.
Larry. Okay. Someone suffering from chronic back pain right between the shoulder blades. Why don't you stand up? Thank you, Lord. You tell your husband that there's not going to be any residual effect to this, that he's going to be totally and completely made well. I'm saying that by the Spirit of the Lord. And so you let and allow your faith to just grow and balloon as you pray for him day after day after day till you see complete and total recovery, because God is promising complete and total recovery without anything residual hanging on.
Amen.
That's a promise you can cling to.
Amen. She's a woman of faith.
Who is a person with the chronic issue in their shoulder blades? Why don't you come up, please? Right there. Okay, great. Okay.